So let's say you're working on a project for your local vehicle department. You're tasked with modeling a driving license object. Assume your platform already provides a class called document, which contains some standard implementations to store, retrieve, and display objects. So there will be two choices for you if you are intent on reusing the existing code and not reinvent the wheel. One would be to subclass the document, and the other would be to use the document as an instance variable inside your driving license class. So what would you choose? Driving license is a document, or driving license has a document? So clearly the first choice relies on inheritance and the second on composition. Essentially, inheritance is forming a hierarchy of classes, while composition is assembling a composite class with components. In a simplistic scenario, it shouldn't really matter what you choose. But obviously, the real world is a lot more nuanced and complicated. Joshua Block, in his book Effective Java, gives some compelling arguments on why we should favor composition over inheritance. He explains this beautifully by using the example of a hash set. Let us say that we want to customize some functionality of the hash set and add some instrumentation to count the number of times elements have been added to the set over its lifetime. A simple implementation strategy would be to use inheritance, that is, subclass the hash set and create an instrumented hash set. We first override the add method to increment the count by 1. We also need to override the add all method to increment the count by the size of the list that was added. On first looks, this looks like a workable solution. However, if you run the code, you will find that when adding a list of 3 elements, the output produced is 6 instead of 3. So what happened here? Under the hood, the add all of hash set calls the add method for each element in the input list. And because of inheritance, this side effect propagates to a subclass, and the counts get incremented twice for each element. This can, of course, be fixed directly by changing our implementation, either by not overriding the addAll method or re-implementing it. However, the real issue here is that you are expected to have knowledge of the implementation details of the superclass to arrive at those solutions. What if you're not fully aware of all of these details? This would be problematic, especially for larger and more complex systems, and could induce unintentional errors. Another problem that could arise is that the superclass could acquire new methods in time, which has potential to introduce bugs and holes in the subclass. For example, in our above case, let's say that the hash set later introduced a new method that could also add values to the set. Our subclass wasn't aware of this when it was implemented, and this case would not have been handled, leading to the contract of the instrumented hash set being violated again. A good solution to this problem is to use composition. We have now defined the instrumented set as a class implementing the mutable set interface. We also have S, an object of type hash set, as an instance member of the instrumented set. All methods of the mutable set interface are now forwarded to this instance member S. This avoids the problems discussed above, and our new class is insulated from implementation changes to the hash set class. The pattern that we see above, where composition is used in conjunction with method forwarding, is called delegation. The composite class instrumented set delegates the implementation to another object, S in this case. Delegation also adds another advantage. If we pull up the type of S to its parent interface, the mutable set, then we can add instrumentation to any implementation of the mutable set interface, for example, a tree set, a hash set, etc., as we see here. However, despite the advantages described, we still have some problems here. If you notice above, we had to explicitly override even methods that we weren't enhancing functionality for. This makes writing forwarders very tedious, making delegation difficult to code for in languages that do not support the feature implicitly. For example, Java. This could be a contributor to why inheritance is misused in situations where delegation or composition is more appropriate. However, Kotlin provides a built-in language feature that allows you to use delegation elegantly, bringing it up to par with the ease of use of interfaces. This is achieved by using the by clause. And this is how we could rewrite the class above in idiomatic Kotlin. The bike class delegates the implementation of the interface to the delegate object. The compiler under the hood would generate all the methods required and the code for forwarding them to the delegate object. We now need to only override the methods that we are really interested in, removing all the boilerplate code, resulting in a concise and readable implementation. This makes composition a breeze to use in Kotlin compared to many other languages. If we get back to our example of the driving license object, even here it wouldn't be the most elegant use of inheritance. If you look at the domain closely, a driving license is not just a special type of document. Of course, it needs to be backed by a document that acts as a record, but it could also have other logic like identity or validation. For example, there could be methods that validate whether a holder is allowed to drive a cargo truck based on logic that's outside the realm of a document. To illustrate this further, let's say a future requirement comes in where a driving license should be used as an identification mechanism. Another identity mechanism already exists in the system, a fingerprint, which already has code implemented that you could reuse in your driving license object. Now, if you're using inheritance to achieve this, you would want to make fingerprint a subclass of document as well and pull up the identification methods to the document class. But fingerprint is already a subclass of biometric and doesn't need all the implementations provided by the document class. Okay, so you then decide to create a superclass for both biometric and document that contains all the functionality required. This is getting more and more messy now, and you have succeeded in creating a god object of sorts, making everything fragile again. A much better way to solve this is to create some interfaces, biometric, document, and ID method, and provide some default implementations for them. The driving license and biometric classes could now be created taking advantage of composition and thereby delegation. You now have a much more stable design while still reusing code and remaining idiomatic. Essentially, we realize the concepts of mixins here, where multiple interface implementations are delegated by a class with ease and terseness. A side note here is that the by keyword is also used to do property delegation in Kotlin. This works in a slightly different context, which we'll cover in depth in a further episode. So we have been talking up composition and delegation, but does this mean that inheritance should be avoided at all costs? Of course not. If there is a clear essay relationship between two classes, that is, a class is without a question a subtype of the other, then by all means inheritance can work. However, even here it should be ensured that they serve the same logical domain and the enhancements made are purely additive. A good example would be while using UI widgets or controls, where all of the above hold true and subclasses often need to rely heavily on the implementation of the base framework classes. A good practice in any case is to use inheritance only on classes that are designed for them. Kotlin by default does not allow classes to be inherited from. Classes that allow subclassing needs to be explicitly qualified by the open keyword. This works perfectly to auto-document inheritability and avoid mistakes. So there you have it. Kotlin provides you all the tools necessary to use composition wherever possible without any language awkwardness. Embrace them to your advantage to write concise, robust, and reusable code. Before we end, I would highly recommend the book Effective Java, which I have extensively referred to in this talk. It is a highly influential book on object-oriented design and Java in general, and is a must-read if you are interested in that sort of thing. That is all, and thanks for listening.